Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for attending. This is a special council meeting here at the Shaw Auditorium for Wednesday, 2013, August 7, and it's 4:30 precisely, and we'd like to call the special meeting to order. And we'll start off with an introduction to lead items. Ms. King.
Thank you, Your Worship. We are adding a delegation from Mr. Robert Fuller, and we are removing 19 delegations of the 56 that were on the agenda. As well, Dominic Jones and Tom Gray have also advised they do not wish to speak this evening. And we are adding recommendation number 5 to the recommendations outlined on page 3 of the agenda. That's it for the late items, Your Worship.
Okay. Thank you very much. So with that, we'll ask for a motion to adopt the agenda as amended. Moved. Seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. And moving into administration. And that will be the 4A Colliery Dam. Note, a final policy statement has not as yet been completed for Council's consideration. However, an interim policy statement has been added as the 5th recommendation, which Ms. King just spoke to briefly. So I believe the list I have is still accurate, but some people may not have shown up. So we're going to ask everyone to respect the 5-minute timeline for everyone on this. And the first delegation we have is Ms. Donna Holt. Is Ms. Holt present?
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor and Council members. My name is Donna Holt. I live at 2379 Porcupine Hill Trail. I've been asked to tell you what I saw at the dam the other night. Monday night, about 8:30 p.m., a friend and I were walking up the pond, up the paved path past the first dam, and we stopped at the little beach there. Good heavens. And with our dogs, and we saw at least 2, possibly 3 baby otters. They were swimming near the shore. They didn't worry about our dogs at all, and they were just beautiful to watch. There were at least 2, I think maybe there were 3. They dove under and then popped up, and they came closer and closer to us, and it was just a beautiful moment. We stood there for about 10 minutes watching these little guys. And God help us if we have so little humanity in us that we can destroy the habitat and lives of such beautiful creatures. The very next night, I was walking across the bridge at the second dam, and a mother and her was rounding up her 3 little boys to go home. They had buckets and jars full of goodness knows what, I think crayfish and minnows or something, but it was alive at any rate. And she told them they had to put all the live things back in the water because they had to go back to their families, but they could come back and play with them again tomorrow night. Another wonderful moment. I've met families at the dam who homeschool their children, and to them, Colliery Dam is their science classroom. And 5 years ago, I rescued an immature great horned owl at the very bottom of the first dam down that big, stiff, steep cliff. And I took it up to the Wildlife Rescue Center at Errington, and up to Robin Campbell, who does all the wildlife rescue. And 8 weeks later, Robin Campbell came down, and we released it back, right back to where it was. And it flew up in the tree and glowered at us for some time. So obviously, there's an owl's nest up there. And I don't think we have any business destroying these things. I've also seen students and instructors from VIU looking for and finding the elusive orange-bellied salamander, and I've seen them up there too. Also living at Colliery are the red-legged frog and the western toad, both of which have shrunken numbers and are on the endangered species watch list. Surely we have some responsibility to ensure the continued survival of these species. Obviously, the ecosystem at Colliery is teeming, well-balanced, fragile unit that needs to be respected and cared for. The parts of this fragile ecosystem depend on the whole, and the people of Nanaimo are depending on the council to save this beautiful and fragile place. I respectfully ask the council to take the next year, make use of the experts in many fields that the Colliery Dam Preservation Society has assembled, and along with First Nations, come up with a solution that satisfies safety, fresh fish habitat, and the heart and soul and heritage of Nanaimo. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next delegation is Mr. Tim McGrath. Again, 5 minutes. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Council. I won't take your full 5 minutes. I want to thank City Council for considering their recommendation by staff. I want to thank some councillors, obviously a little bit more than others, but I do want to thank each and every one of you. It has been an emotional situation here in Nanaimo, and I hope that we can put those feelings to rest and that we can get on with saving the Colliery Dams. The only addition, and I don't know whether you, how you would perceive it, but I would like to see the Colliery Dam Preservation Society become a full shareholder in the process rather than just the public. You know, they have been pretty well selected as our spokesperson. They're open, they're willing to discuss it, and quite honestly, I would value their opinion. And if they make a recommendation, I would wholeheartedly support it. So thank you very much.
Okay, sir, thank you. The next delegation is Ms. Geraldine Collins. Ms. Collins?
She's not present.
Not present? Okay, next one is Mr. Gord Fuller.
Gord Fuller, 604 Nickel Street. I want to say that I'm fully in support of staff's recommendation that the current tender to remove the dams be canceled and that continued engagement with Nanaimo First Nations and the public occur over the winter with the goal of agreeing on a solution early in the spring to provide enough time for design and permitting for a solution to mitigate the risks of the dams. I'm glad that after a short hiatus, the city and Nanaimo reinitiated the consultation process called for by Chief Doug White on July 8th, and that since resuming, even more information has been gathered, which sheds new light on the issue of the Colliery Dams. I really want to thank Catherine Gordon and those working with her for doing an exceptional job in this process. I only caught the last 1.5 hours of the roundtable discussions last Wednesday, but I was extremely impressed by the quality of the presentations. Presentations, many of which call into question the results of the following reports and perhaps others I'm not aware of. These reports include Clone Krippenberger's conceptual review of overwinter pumping options, middle and lower Chase dams. The costs seem quite exorbitant when at one meeting a contractor mentioned $400,000 while the dams were removed and replaced. So it seems a few million and 400,000 just don't gel. The conceptual cost of rehabilitation and replacement options from April that Clone Krippenberger did up. This is a report that the city added another 30% contingencies to when they were already included. And a number of the presentations the other day actually came up with some better ideas and solutions than this report. The other is the Associated Engineering Chase River Dam Breach Flood Inundation Study of September 2012. There was a really good presentation by Thomas Warden that contradicted some of the statements in that, and I believe it really needs to be looked at again. This was originally received by the city in late June, early July of 2012, but it wasn't brought forward to council until October of 2012. So there's a few months they're missing. Perusing some of the documents today, I came across one option not even looked at in the Clone Krippenberger conceptual costing of rehabilitation and replacement options. And this is from the middle and lower Chase River Dam spillway hydrology study done in April of 2002. And it talked about to address probable maximum flood mitigation. And one of the recommendations was to construct an emergency overflow spillway in a new location, and the advantage of this option is that the existing dams and spillways can be left unchanged with only minor modifications. I'm not going to get into the rest of it. It's on page 14 of that report if you're interested. The construction cost of the spillway, which is shown in there, and they show how it would look, would have been just over $1 million, actually. $1,076,625,000. And those costs included in that option include contingencies, taxes, and engineering studies. That's a pretty good cost for something that could actually really help in this situation. And it wasn't even looked at in that report. By no means do I imply this is the best option, but it is certainly worth further inspection and one that could allow for the retention of current dams. When it comes to reports posted on the city website, I must also mention some of those that are not and should be. The letter from the Heritage Commission to the city of Nanaimo is not on the website. Clone Krippenberger Stage 1 Biophysical Assessment Fish Habitat, Wildlife, and Vegetation Report of February 2013, not on the website. And in that report, it actually mentions the otters living there. My guess is there are others that should be posted to the website as well. Who makes a decision on what goes to the website and what not to post? I've mentioned before that through necessity, when a process such as has happened regarding the Colliery Dams, where the community is not invited into the discussion, many in the public become experts and many existing experts come forward. This has proved to be very true on the part of many members of the Colliery Dams Preservation Society. We must value what they bring to the table in these discussions and not simply discount their input because
okay,
they are
we're
not
up to
perceived.
5 minutes now, so.
On just last
thanks.
Sentence.
Yep.
We must value what they bring to the table in these discussions and not simply discount their input because they are not perceived to be so-called professionals. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, the next delegation is Ms. Trish Kuziak, if I pronounce that correctly.
My name is Trish Kuziak, and I live at 761 Bowman Avenue. Good evening, Mayor and Council. What I'm about to say is pretty much my feelings over the summer, so there might be a couple points that don't make sense tonight. Okay, when I decided to speak at tonight's meeting, I went and sat at the dam to find the words I wanted to speak. So many thoughts and feelings ran through me. I sat there looking at the reflection on the lake and then scanned the shoreline. It was like watching an old home movie. Like numerous other people in my family and the community, I grew up at the dam and can ramble off memories. Like my dad teaching me to fish off the bridge at the second dam, swimming with my older brothers, summer picnics with my family, and biking through the trails with my friends. When I had a family of my own, I took them there and we started the Harewood Yacht Club. RC boats and homemade boats out of watermelon boxes. Anyway, I love taking my boys there and showing them my favorite spots from my childhood. I want to be able to take my grandchildren there and to be able to tell them stories of when their dads were little boys and to show them a piece of the city's history. My 19-year-old son and I walked by the new reservoir construction zone a few weeks ago on the way to the falls, and it initiated a conversation about current events. I thought he was aware of everything that was going on, but like a lot of young people, he wasn't. So as we walked, he asked quite a few questions, and I answered what I could. To see the sadness, anger, and disbelief in his eyes was heartbreaking. The Colliery Dam has always been a special place for him since he was little. It all started back in grade 2 or 3, when his school had a track meet at the dam. He was one of the last ones to finish, but he could have cared less. All he could talk about was how beautiful his surroundings were. He said, "Mom, do you know that people spend tons of money to go to places just like this? We're sure lucky to have it right here in Harewood." Since that day, he has gone to the park to get into his zone before any game. He gets up, grabs his music, and heads to the lakes to mentally prepare. He's been offered scholarships to universities such as UBC, University of Calgary, Acadia, and the list goes on. But at the end of the day, they were turned down because he wanted to play here in his hometown and have a special spot close by. He has recently started his second season with the VI Raiders as one of the defensive captains, but the last thing he wants is to watch a piece of himself being destroyed. In this day and age, it's nice to be able to unplug your kids and give them the same opportunity we had growing up, to explore and use their imagination in a natural setting. This whole ordeal has my 8-year-old wanting to form an army to protect the dams. He's a smart little critter and understands the whole process, but he just doesn't understand how certain people are supposed to be working for the best interest of the city and can destroy what little of it we have left. It's pretty damn sad that an 8-year-old can appreciate the value of his hometown history, but 5 people we elected don't. I had something that I wanted to say, but the person's not here tonight. I truly want to believe in my council and have tried so hard to look at both sides of the issue with an open mind, but a lot of the information councillors have given the citizens just doesn't add up. I've heard numerous rumors throughout the community, and frankly, they make me feel ill. This is Nanaimo, not Victoria, not Vancouver. If I wanted to live in a place with high density housing and super schools, I'd move there. We stay here in Nanaimo because of the community feel it has. I admit that I've never paid too much attention to local politics in the past. I voted and just assumed that city council was looking out for our best interest. How naive am I? My eyes have been opened up to a whole new world of lies and bullying, and this summer made me ashamed of how city council was run. But on the other hand, I am so proud of the people I've met over the last few months through this cause. People who, if this didn't happen, I probably wouldn't have had the opportunity to get to know. So thank you. Thank you for giving us the chance to meet our neighbors again and create these friendships. When I joined in the fight to save the dams, it was 100% for my boys. Now it's for them, my new friends, and future residents of this beautiful city. And it's turned into such a bigger issue than just the Collery Dams. It's about the way the city is run. Lastly, thank you to the councilman who took time out of his busy schedule to talk to us. Like real people, I cannot put into words how much I appreciate that. The city is packed full of brilliant people. Please stop assuming that we're idiots. Thank you.
Just a statement.
Okay, would the last speaker come down? There's a question.
It's all right, Your Worship.
Do you want to or not?
I just wanted to say that the Miskusiak's son, Jordan, not only plays for the VI Raiders, but he also plays for the Nanaimo Timbermen. And anybody who wants to see him play can see him this Saturday at Caledonia Park.
Okay, thank you. And now the next delegation is Ms. Christina Zurita, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Ms. Zurita? Okay, the next one is Ms. Judy Frobisher.
Good afternoon, Mayor Rattan and Council. My name is actually Judy Forbister, but don't feel bad, it gets mispronounced all the time.
Oh, sorry, yeah, I see you're right, thank you.
First of all, I wish to acknowledge appreciation for the city's change of direction in the short term regarding the Collery Dams. I'm sure we can all use a little respite. I'm grateful for the involvement of Chief White and his staff and all the hard work they've done, as well as the joint facilitator that was put in the position to put all this together. And I am very, very proud of the community, which includes all the good people out here who have worked very, very hard for many months. Hard work, shown great tenacity. They've come together, as you know, they're doing research, they're looking for solutions, they've taken action, and they continue to educate others in this community about the Collery Dams. That's fabulous. I believe that nothing happens by coincidence. And this whole thing that's happened isn't a coincidence. It's an opportunity to learn. I certainly have learned from the experience over the last 10 months. The biggest lesson for me is that when decisions or choices are made out of fear, they will inevitably be the wrong ones and the wrong outcomes. Now we have time, as you've said, Mr. Mayor, to carefully examine the research and options and hopefully come up with the best choices agreeable to the Nanaimo First Nation, the city, and the community. The ecosystem must be in the center of future planning. To destroy one part will inevitably impact the rest of the system. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker we have is Mr. Sean Williams on behalf of Ms. Louise Guilfoy. Mr. Williams? Up to 5 minutes, sir.
In Nanaimo? So, real quick about me. I've lived in Nanaimo about 15 years. Before that, I was a resident of the areas of Shuswap Lake and Adams River. After leaving the Shuswap Lake area, I joined the Navy and became a clearance diver, where I learned to use sonar, radar, all underwater explosives. Okay, so I left the Navy and got an education, UVic, VIU, worked for DFO and various other NGOs, non-government organizations, and my passion, and I specialize in environmental interactions, basically how humans affect the natural environment. So is a photo of me and my son at the Middle Dam. And I did a quick survey of the Middle Dam, took some photos, and used an underwater metal detector to identify any metal that could be in the concrete. So it's the above water observations of the concrete structure and substructures. I found positive hits on the metal throughout the structure. It appeared to be reinforcing. Looks like the dam is constructed on a bedrock base, the natural basin. And I really didn't see where, if at all, where it would fall if there was a catastrophic event. It's really tough to see the metal in here, but all these photos have reinforcing properties, I-beams, bars, that kind of thing. And they're spread out throughout the dam. And it's important to note that the bottom right picture there is the dam wall below the waterline. And what you see at the waterline is a pitting and some degradation where the water meets the air kind of thing. And these are also photos of, looks like, I-beam penetrating the wall, the dam. Underwater, the concrete looks less degraded, less pitting. In my opinion, it's very good. And the base structure is also supported by large concrete blocks. And the bedrock base has potential reinforcing properties as well. These are hard to see, but on the bottom left is, oh, the pointer, yeah, okay. So the bottom left is man-made concrete with steel, the wall. And these are all bedrock cliffs just below the dam. Look pretty sturdy to me. The other thing is I've been doing this literature review of watersheds with similar properties as the Colliery Dam and the Chase River watersheds, and all defendable, repeatable research done, and it shows beaver dams, which I kind of relate to the structures on the Chase River, slow water, and they use them as models for ecosystem rehabilitation of threatened and endangered species. They use them for remediation, public education awareness, and they modify them as needed for as they see fit for negative and positive benefits, and they all test them against change if they weren't there. So there's a few local companies in town that study this kind of stuff. Contama Research, Dr. David Welsh, a world expert on fish survival, ocean survival. And so the benefits, real quick, the benefits of these bodies of water are, I think, are huge. And the flora and fauna, basically the plants and animals in there, is basically a major nutrient source, delivery, filtration, downstream. The bad stuff, the metals settle out in these ponds, the food grows, and is transported downstream to the lower reaches. If you take those out, I'm not sure what happens with that sediment, if that can be mitigated. Real quick, lots of fish, lots of shellfish. These were taken a few days ago. Lots of crayfish and the urban aquatic potential. This is you could tie in the government, First Nations, academic as a study area. And what needs to be done is a feasibility study for the environmental conditions. I see it all benefits, participation, supplementation, and preservation. The benefits are, in my opinion, quite huge. So,
okay, thank you, sir. Now the next delegation is Mr. Matthew O'Donnell. Oh, sorry, Councillor Bessig, I'm sorry. I looked, you must have just slipped it in. I wasn't watching, sorry.
Can he come back?
Yeah, the gentleman that just spoke, sorry. There's a couple of questions here I missed. Councillor Bessig.
Thank you very much for your presentation and to those that preceded you. You mentioned in your presentation that you noticed not only rebar, and it's been suggested in previous engineers' reports that there may not have been any, and if there was, we didn't know how much and at what distances and, you know, how were it protruded to and so on. And that's a comment, but the question is, you also mentioned an I-beam. Could you explain to me the difference of that property and what you think it would do to the security of the dams?
Well, do you want to just try to put the photo up there, or I can just comment? Well,
you can comment.
The I-beams I found in obviously the original dam structure, and it looked like they were running the placement of them, diagonally through the length of the dam, which I found some literature to state that acts as an energy dispersal mechanism that engineers use. So it actually undulates. If you can remember the Golden Gate Bridge, the video of that undulating. I think that is a method they used in the past for energy dispersal. So the I-beams were obviously there. There's photos of them. Again, I have all the references and all the photos. If anybody cares to see them, I have no problems.
Thank you. So in your professional opinion, the I-beam, the rebar, the bedrock, the concrete base, man-made, whatever?
All benefits.
All benefits. Second question, please.
In mind.
Yeah, thank you. It's also been suggested by some of the reports that we've received from the professional engineers that the concrete has weakened to a point where it's unsafe. You mentioned in your report that you don't believe that to be the case.
Visually, and that's all I can speak about, underwater, I think I haven't seen any other photos or any data suggesting that data was collected below the surface of the water. So. I didn't see any big penetrating cracks or sloughing or anything like that. So again, I can photos and, you know, there are things you can do, non-destructive testing, you know, dam safety, they have standards and that I haven't seen any of that data either. So penetrating sonar, that can give you a virtual interior map of structure. So.
Thank you. And my last question, Your Worship, you have a very diverse background, and if I understand, you're also a biologist,
yeah.
And so you have very strong opinions on the value of the ecosystem in both dams and its cause and effect if they were to be removed. Would you care to comment, please?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, real quick, I've just come into this in the last couple of weeks, been reading and diving down and looking at it, and I found ample literature
from other organizations, other parts of the world that have these bodies of water, and they basically are they fertilize themselves because of the still water, which causes food to grow. Not only does it provide areas for coal to foraging behaviors, it pumps food downstream. Basically, if you can, how the water's warmer in the still water as the flowing water. Well, the plants are growing, which is the primary productivity, which feeds the invertebrates and the bugs, and which act as food flowing over the dams down to the lower reaches. And the metals, there's also lots of evidence stating that metal accumulation from mines are a huge problem, and deforestation also creates this pollution that the ponds, the reservoirs, settle out. So I didn't do any sediment samples, but I think a study needs to be done, a defendable, repeatable study needs to be done on the sediment, the oxygen content, and the biophysical inhabitants. Defendable peer-reviewed research stating what's there. So I did find juvenile salmon. It's not, I couldn't really tell if they were rainbow trout, and some of the reports that the ministry has put out said you can't positively ID them as rainbow trout. They should be assumed steelhead. So that, there's all kinds of stuff. Lots of crayfish, lots of sculpins, salmonids, perch.
Thank you very much.
Councillor Kip.
Thank you. A lot of my questions were answered or asked there. Your background as a Navy diver was construction and demolition.
My background was evaluation and demolition. Not construction, but we were going to for training a structure that needed to be removed. We would have to decide how much explosives it was needed to destroy. That's how I my experience.
And in your experience, it would take a bit to move that, wouldn't it?
A lot.
Yeah. Okay. Now the biological inventory. If I can continue, the biological value you mentioned quickly in your slides about the school values and the university values. You said that there. I mean, this is 100 years of a new pond. Is that what you're
saying?
That's
right. And that's the thing that to change is. Can cause all kinds of issues, and to be able to get that those bodies of water back to producing algae, producing food, producing invertebrates, which is all food for some monocular fishes. But I just can relate it to my experiences in the Adams River. There's hundreds, thousands and thousands of school trips that children would come, and they'd watch these salmon go up man-made fish ladders sometimes. And I've seen nothing there, and then they put stuff in or supplemented the habitat that was there, and then the sockeye runs would be exponentially more dense. So To have a food source and a potential study area right in our backyard, I think is invaluable, because they're already conditioned. That's the big thing. Those areas are conditioned, and animals can grow there. They know it, and it's a total benefit.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we have one more question before you go. Oh. And one more point, too. I think when you were referring earlier, I think it was the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, I think you talked about, where that started oscillating in the wind and that.
Yeah.
It's quite I've watched on television several times. Councillor Patchy.
Thank you, Worship. Thank you, Mr. Williams. At the round table discussion of late last week, was it you who showed a piece of rebar that went around?
Yes, that's...
Okay. How did you get that piece?
Sorry?
How did you get it? It's thick.
Sharp piece off and make it smooth. So I just kept it. Looked like it's hazardous to me.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor McKay, one more question.
Thank you. In previous life, I spent a lot of time going up and down the coast, and one of the things I was always amazed at was looking at the trees as they got to the high water mark, and they were just so perfectly manicured all the way along. And I see the same thing at Collery. Can you tell me, just imagine for a second, or if you have an opinion on it in any way, shape, or form, you, with that interdependence with the water, and all of a sudden you pull the plug and there's no water there, what happens to those trees?
They start walking towards the water. So terrestrial, which are land, plants and vegetation and all that kind of stuff, starts to encroach on that area that was once habitat for fish or whatever. So the problem arises that when that's recolonized by the land, the water comes back up and you decide to re-flood it. That can create a really big problem when it starts to deteriorate. So the breakdown of organic matter in that water could use up, in my opinion, could all the oxygen, and then all of a sudden we're pumping water downstream that doesn't have any oxygen for that. And there's research that shows that happens. So, that area will get used. If you drain it or whatever, it will get used.
Thank you.
Good. I see no further questions. Thank you. Okay. The next speaker is Matthew O'Donnell. Welcome, sir.
Hi there. Matthew O'Donnell. First of all, I'd just like to thank Councillor Kipp, Beswick, Patchy, and McKay for, in my opinion, holding their ground and speaking their mind and using reason and logic and, real studies and stuff like that. So I just want to thank them. Sorry, guys, I'm tired. I'd like to also acknowledge, hopefully, Councillor Brennan Greaves, Mayor Tan, Councillor Johnstone, and Mr. Anderson there for, hopefully voting to on the staff recommendation there. And I'd also like to acknowledge even the city workers there for finally, in my opinion, coming to their senses and making a proper staff recommendation. And I'd really like to thank Chief Doug White and the Sinema First Nations, because without them, basically, this would have went a completely different direction. The dams would probably, we'd be starting the deconstruction process by now, and they really changed the course of this story. It could have been really bad this summer. And I really, really want to thank them. Like, thank God for Chief Doug White. And thank God that you guys listened to him. Because God knows he didn't listen to us, as in the people. About 2 months ago or whatever, you had like 40 people come out here for about 3 hours, pouring their heart out. You had scientists, architects, you had just citizens. You had all kinds of people basically explaining why they want to keep the dams. I didn't see many people speak as a delegation in support of tearing the dams down, but you didn't listen to them. In some cases, you just kind of sneered at them and were rather ignorant. I think that's, again, thank God for Doug White.
Okay.
And also, just I'll close it off really quickly by saying election season's coming up, and because hopefully this will, this is going to be readdressed next spring, might become an election issue. Hope y'all remember that, because I'm pretty sure we're not going to forget it, and I'm pretty sure there's going to be a lot of us who are going to make sure that the general public, the 26% of people who vote, are going to remember
it. Thank you. You've made your point.
That's fine.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Rattan.
Next speaker is Melody Wilton.
Your Worship, Ms. Wilton has indicated that she no longer wishes to speak.
Okay,
sorry
fine.
About that.
Thank you. Ms. Crystal Martin. Oh, okay.
Good evening. Sorry, I had too much Wi-Fi exposure in the last 2 days, so I'm having the irritable bladder syndrome. Okay. any case, well, first of all, I want to thank you for, thank the four of you for sticking with it until everybody else got on board, and I want to thank everybody else for finally opening their minds and hearts and paying some attention to the rest of us. So to me, that's important. And something came across my computer which was kind of funny. It says that having an open mind doesn't mean that your brains fall out, but it does mean that you're open to new information and that you desire new information. So I like that. I'm going to give you some new information that will affect what you do to parks in Nanaimo, and in particular to Collery Dam, because it's a refuge. As Donna Holt already mentioned, it's a refuge for wildlife, and it's a refuge for an awful lot of people who are really sick. The BC Center of Disease Control, in the last 2 weeks, has come out with a notice that says that cell phone radiation causes sterility in men. It also causes sterility in women, but that's harder to find. Takes longer. They're starting to read and acknowledge the unbiased science, just like you guys are, and I'm really pleased about that. Next one. You've heard me talk before about the calcium and magnesium balance in your cells and how that can affect your health. Dr. Martin Paul of the Washington State University figured out how that works and how alteration in calcium levels inside your cells causes heart attacks and muscle spasms, including in your blood vessels. Something to consider. And that's as a result of wireless radiation. Massachusetts Institute of Technology just printed a report about magnetic fields changing people's sense of morality. There's a spot on the right side of your head, just where your antenna sits. And if a magnetic field, as from a cell phone, is on that area for any length of time, you become essentially amoral. For the moment, it's a temporary effect, because nobody's really figured out how long it has to be there to make it permanent. But it's there.
Okay, remember, we need to try to link it as closely to Collery Dam as you can.
It is Collery Dam.
Okay.
So it seems to me the city wasted a lot of taxpayers' money ignoring existing engineering reports about rebar and things like that already in the dams, and a fair amount getting new ones that said maybe there wasn't because they hadn't read the old ones yet. And I'm going to ask you, just think how much money you're going to waste if you allow Shaw to install public Wi-Fi throughout Nanaimo publicly and in the parks. And if personal liability was an issue with the parks, with the Collery Dams, at 150 people maybe dying if, when, then maybe, then consider this. 5% of 90,000 people in Nanaimo is 4,500 people. You can expect that that many of us are electrosensitive. If you then take the 30% that are having effects but don't know why, that's another 27,000. And that's a lot of people having heart attacks or strokes for no apparent reason but microwave radiation. It seems to me that when you opened your minds to look at what's really going on with Collery Dams, you left room there to learn new things. And I'm asking you to learn new things about public Wi-Fi, about cell towers, and about the effects that this has on everybody. It's not just me. It's not just me and my bladder running in and out the door here. Unfortunately, like everybody else, you were forced to by Chief Doug White and the members of the community who were like little bulldogs who just wouldn't let go no matter what. And I feel sad that it had to get that far. But there you are. Even the people in government higher than you guys now are starting to listen. The Centers of Disease Control, MIT. There is a study out of Israel that talks about direction changes in your sense of direction being caused by Wi-Fi, by cell towers. They already knew about that for bats, but they finally found the place in human brains where it does it. So it seems to me personal liability, 45,000 people, that's a, you know, 27,000 people, that's a lot of people. That's a lot more than 150.
Okay, that's the 5 minutes. So if you could wind it up, please.
So I'm asking you to just basically keep your minds open to all the new information you get,
apply it to the Colliery Dams. It is a wildlife refuge, and it is a people refuge, because we're just critters too, and what happens to them happens to us.
Okay, thank you very much. The next speaker is Mr. Jim Taylor.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. Jim Taylor in Nanaimo. I've paid attention to this whole dam issue since last November, I think it was, when we were told that we had a 40% chance these dams were going to fall apart and it was going to cost us $30 million to replace both of them. Right up till I was at this last meeting on July the 31st that was put on by the facilitator, Gordon. A couple of points I made at that particular meeting is if we were to consider that the safety standards we're applying at Westwood Dam is an acceptable level of risk for our community, if we were to apply the same standards to the Colliery Dams, we wouldn't be having this long, drawn-out discussion. Those dams up at Colliery were mitigated against whatever they thought the problem was there for about $500,000 a few years ago. These loss of life hypotheticals that we keep getting advanced and we're told how dangerous this whole situation is, it seems to be that the numbers are really only acceptable and believable as if we had such a catastrophic event hit Nanaimo that the rest of Nanaimo would probably be left uninhabitable anyway. Going back to a 2010 seismic report, which the city commissioned to have done, one of the recommendations in that particular study, there were three options put forward to deal with the Colliery Dams. One of the suggestions was that if you had decided to replace the dams, and this was the recommendation given at that time by that engineer, was if you're going to replace the dams, and his recommendation was that the majority, if not all, of the existing dams would be left in place. The reason to leave them in place is to preserve the existing aesthetics and to minimize the costs associated with removing them. So back in 2010, they said, if you're really going to have to replace these, leave as much of them in place as you can. They also went on to explain that if you're going to deal with the Lower Chase Dam, that in that dealing with that one, the most feasible, reliable option consists of constructing a new gravity dam downstream of the existing dam. In other words, leave the one in place that's already there. And then the void between the two structures could be backfilled with rock fill if a cushioning layer or finer material was placed against the concrete structure to protect it from damage. Now, that recommendation makes as much sense today as it did back in 2010. There's nothing changed engineeringly that I can figure out. Another option that was in that 2010 study that seems to just be forgotten is that in that seismic study, it was recommended one of the other options was to rehabilitate the dams. And the estimates that were given at that time was that to bring both dams up to a 1-in-3,000-year safety standard, and this would include remediation of the spillway, was going to cost in the neighborhood between $2.5 and $3 million. So in other words, back in 2010, if we'd spent $3 million, we would have had both dams brought up to a 1-in-3,000 safety standard, the spillways would have been taken care of, and we wouldn't have gone through this whole little 9-month drama. Another thing that was, again, tucked away in that 2010 seismic study is they keep referring to a low-level conduit that exists in the middle dam. And they say that that low-level conduit, they kept calling for it being decommissioned. So in other words, if it's there and it needs to be decommissioned, then obviously it could be put into service. So if we're looking for some way of lowering the pressure and lowering the water in that middle dam, and apparently in that 2010 report, it says that their diver did find it, even though it wasn't found when they, back in the whatever year it was, when they actually dewatered and rebuilt on that dam, they were looking for this low-level conduit. They couldn't find it, but the diver apparently found it. In the 2010 report, it gives exact location exactly where it is. And then finally, another point needs to be made is that we should have an independent commission, body of professionals, I don't know who you'd call on, but to examine all these different risk hypotheticals that we've been throwing out as to how dangerous Nanaimo has suddenly become. We're going to have this 10,000-year flood at the same time we're going to have a 10 on the Richter scale earthquake is going to hit Nanaimo. Now, if we really have those kind of data to support that kind of concern, I think that the rest of the community should be made aware of it so that we can all make an informed, intelligent decision whether we want to stay in this dangerous city of Nanaimo. Thank you. Cool.
Now, the next speaker is Mr. Ron Steed. Mr. Steed?
Thank you. Hi, Ron Stead, 337504 Road. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Kipp, Mr. Bestwick, Mr. Padgett, and Mr. McKay for their support of our endeavor to save the dams from people who don't seem to give a damn. Anyway, I've got a little analysis that I did on the 2012 inundation or seismic report, and it goes as follows. I contend that the city senior staff, Mr. Kenny, Mr. Sims, Ms. Clift, Mr. Hickey, Mr. Harding, Mayor Rutten, and council members, Ms. Brennan, Mr. Greaves, Ms. Johnson, and Mr. Anderson of the staff and council, from here on to be known as S&C, have no supporting evidence to justify the destruction of the Harewood Colliery dams. The S&C has attempted to justify the destruction through the use of seismic and inundation studies, which were based by the engineer's own admission on the paucity of information and facts as is evidenced for the destruction of the dams. Translated, paucity means a scarcity, scant, very little information upon which to base their reports and conclusions. To develop their report, the engineers had to create their own information, facts, and conclusions through the use of guesswork based on a lot of unknowns, their intuition, assumptions, presumptions, inferences.
Okay, Mr. Stead, this isn't an attack on staff.
This is all in their report.
Just listen to me when I'm talking. I want you to be respectful of staff, okay? It wasn't innuendo and guesswork. They hired engineers. Sir.
Excuse me.
And if you want to continue speaking, lower your voice or you're finished, okay? Lower your voice or you're over.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
These words are in their report. I did not make them up. Based on a lot of unknowns, their intuition, assumption, presumptions, inference, conjecture, assertions, deductions, and assessments, using incomplete, inaccurate testing and examinations, and incomplete, inaccurate.
Okay.
Is in their report, sir.
Listen,
you
read it. They never put that in a report. You figured that out in your mind. We've hired engineers to look at this information and provide us with the information on it.
Sir, this is from the KCB. 2012, or no, I'm sorry, it's okay. Not KCB.
We're not attacking staff. We're not attacking staff. We're not attacking staff. If you want to make a comment about the Colliery Dams, please do so, sir.
Sir, I don't mean to attack anyone. I'm just trying to inform people.
Well, you're referring to innuendo and a lot of things like that that's misleading.
Excuse me, I didn't catch that.
What? Innuendo? And
no,
you
sir.
Made reference
to
that.
No, sir, if you were to read the report, you would see.
We're just not going to have any attacks.
They have said themselves that this is what they based their information on. It was not any.
I can't accept that the staff would base it on innuendo, okay? That's my response to you. Now, you've got about a minute left, so let her go.
Did I use the word innuendo? I did not use the word innuendo.
Let's go if you want to. You've got less than a minute now.
Well, all I can say, sir, is. I watched your TV interview the other day where you used the word catastrophic.
Yeah, I did.
That doesn't sound like you're too what's the word?
Unbiased.
Yeah, really. Unbiased and prejudiced. I was really just disappointed when I heard you say that. I thought that you were going to work together with people and with the...
Well, that's what we're going to do for this winter, for sure, if council supports that motion that's on the floor tonight.
You're certainly not providing a very strong base for working together with people on this.
We're starting, we've got the
when
winter.
When you're saying things like that, sir, and I can tell
if
right,
a dam fails...
I will...
Listen to me. If a dam fails... Is that not a catastrophic event, in your opinion? These are kind of yes and no.
Well,
Is it unfair to call it catastrophic?
I foresee a lot of other dams failing as well.
Yeah, but we're talking about the Colliery Dam. If it fails, that's a catastrophic event.
Well, excuse me, but I don't want to get into an argument here.
No, nor do I.
But, yeah.
Your 5 minutes is up.
Facts are facts, sir. You know, if the dams are affected by an earthquake or some kind of extreme storm, a lot of other ones are going to be extremely affected as well. And there's a lot that are deserving of more consideration for that kind of an
But if the Colliery Dam fails, it's a catastrophic event.
The Colliery Dam doesn't have enough water in it to do anything.
I said if it fails. I didn't say it will fail.
Well, even if
okay, I'm not debating with you, sir. Your time is up.
Right.
Thank you for coming.
May I say
no?
I can't.
Thank
close?
You. Stand down, sir.
At least I'm going to
Next
be able
delegation
to sleep
is
with my
Mr. or Ms. Roblin Hunter. Ms. Hunter, not here. Okay. Then we go down to Mr. Norm Abbey. Mr. Abbey, up to 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you, Your Worship, and Council, and the Internet Technology Guy. If you could find my presentation, I've emailed this to you all, so you have a chance to look at it at your leisure. There's footnotes and so on you can click on. I would like to see some serious consideration of the heritage value of the Colliery Dams. Heritage buildings and sites are not renewable resources, and it's up to the mayor and the council to protect them. For a start, and here's two specific requests that I have. I would like to specifically request that you direct staff to post the attached December 17 letter from Nanaimo's Community Heritage Commission. This is on page 3 of the email I sent you. I do not understand why this letter was not posted in the Colliery Dam's information section or anywhere at all on the city website. There's nothing in the Colliery Dam discussion about heritage other than that letter. So I would like that to be posted prominently. And so that's one recommendation.
Sorry, Mr. Abbey, there's a comment here.
Yeah.
Councillor Rennie, go ahead.
Oh, thank you.
It has been posted.
I understand it has now been posted.
I hope it's posted where people will see it. Like
on the web.
On the website.
Somewhere on the website. I'd like to see it specifically where people will see it.
Staff can help me with this, but I think it's on the Colliery Dam's link.
Yes, and so that's just one example of the things Gord Fuller was talking about earlier. So I don't want to repeat that, but that's one prime example of information. And I hope that as part of this learning experience that our communications plan can develop a process, a clear process. So not just this discussion, but every controversial discussion we have, there should be a process for getting stuff onto the website and not having biased.
No, I think you're absolutely right. I think it was an oversight on our part because it was our own staff that worked on that particular report, and it should have been on the website, and that corrections have since been made.
Thank you. So a clear process for posting similar relevant information, especially when controversial issues include disputed or incomplete information or outright disinformation. And if you look at the slide that he's got up there now, that's a loony on the left, and that's rebar from the middle dam. It's an inch and a quarter. I think it's 32 millimeters. It's larger than a loony. And could you slide down to the second photograph? That is humongous rebar. If you can see that, that's the kind of rebar that the building we're standing in right now or sitting in. That's 5/8 inch standard rebar. So maybe that was an oversight too, but that kind of information needs to be up there. In terms of heritage, the Colliery Dams are among the last remaining physical evidence of Nanaimo's coal mining past. Even though Harewood only amalgamated with Nanaimo less than 40 years ago, this last year alone has seen three dramatic and irreversible losses of our coal mining history. One, going, gone. Built in 1914, the Harewood School, about the same time as the dams, the Harewood School seems to be headed for the garbage dump. Here's what Nanaimo's Heritage Register has to say about it. Quote, Harewood School is significant because it speaks to the direct role local coal companies played in shaping the physical and social development of the Nanaimo area. In 1884, Samuel Robbins, superintendent of the Vancouver Coal Mining Company, purchased Harewood Estates, a large parcel of land between Nanaimo and the base of Mount Benson. Robin subdivided this area into 5-acre farms and made them available to mining families at affordable prices. The company also determined the location and donated the school site. Robbins envisioned farming as a way for miners to provide themselves whenever the coal markets were depressed. And there's a couple of footnotes you can click on if you want to follow the news coverage of that. Number two, this one is already gone. The last of Robbins' 5-acre farms at 563rd Street, it was rezoned last year to allow for a large residential development. Number three, also gone in the last year, built at the 1910 Dickinson Barn at 752 Howard Street. This barn and farm supplied most of Harewood with milk, cheese, and butter, among other goods. There's a news article link there. The news article also notes that discussion of that particular barn is timely as society moves back towards local food sustainability. There's some good online comments that I won't read, but I would like to repeat a comment about the heritage value of these dams from Professor Eric Ricker, a retired university professor. He's noted an economic opportunity, which I'd like to repeat. Dr. Ricker says the two dams are valuable community assets. Tourism analysts say that heritage tourism constitutes about 30% of that market. The Colliery Dams, if effectively promoted as part of a Nanaimo area or Vancouver Island area heritage tourism package, would and could play a significant role. These dams are among the last remaining evidence of the industry that built Nanaimo and constituted the basis of Vancouver Island's well-being for over 80 years. They should be remediated.
Okay, sir, we're up to 6 minutes now.
I'm just about done.
Thank you.
If a careful investigation reveals that it is possible to do so at a reasonable cost. In summary, after dramatic and irreversible heritage losses, the Colliery Dams are now the last remaining publicly owned vestige of Nanaimo's coal mining history. Demolishing them would completely delete this heritage. So I speak in support of the staff recommendations, and I thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, the next speaker is Mr. Tom Gray. Mr. Gray?
Your Worship, Mr. Gray is not speaking.
Okay, so we're moving down to Ms. Jennifer Cameron.
But here I am. I'd just like to thank you. I'm really grateful that we have some time to do whatever needs to be done over the next year without, you know, people feeling like it's all getting bulldozed ahead and nothing good is going to come of it. I understand that you're in a difficult position. You have to appease the multitudes as well as keep them safe, and I appreciate that. I really hope over the next year that something great is going to come together here for our community, and thank you again.
So do we. Thank you very much. Okay, the next speaker is Ms. Sandy Blankenship. Is Sandy here? Okay.
Mayor, Council, and staff. I only have three questions that I'd like to ask, and then they will probably be addressed during the rest of the course of the meeting. I would like to say a couple of things, that you have $2.5 million set aside for risk mitigation over the winter months. I understand that's quite a bit of money to do that with, and there, quite a bit can be done with that amount of money. Oh, well, my first question. What is the short-term plan to mitigate the safety put forward last fall until next spring? And is it your intention to drain the reservoirs completely to mitigate the possible threat? My second question, what is the ultimate plan for the Colliery Dam Park when early spring does arrive? My third question, If there is such an extreme risk, why was the council vote not a landslide win? Why did four vote no, if there was such a threat?
Okay.
Those are all the questions I have. I will step back and now these can be answered. I'm sure that a couple of those questions will be answered through the rest of the meeting as it indicates on your sheet.
Thank you.
All right. Yep. Thank you for your time.
Now, the next speaker is Mr. Leon Cake. Mr. Cake.
Thank you. My name is Leon Cake. I live at 5936 Schooner Way. I'm hoping today that we have a positive response to the cancellation of the tender. I just want to go through some points that when we had the roundtable discussion I presented, and I want to present them again for the council members that weren't here. I just want to go back in history and time here and just go forward from where we're at today. The application was submitted by the City of Nanaimo June 15th, and the application was to replace the middle Chase River Dam and the lower Chase River Dam. That application was to replace. We have our regular council meetings minutes May 13th. I won't go through it. I'll just highlight. And in that package, if we came to the motion that was put before City Council, there was one motion made. It was defeated. The motion that went forward was, it was moved and seconded that the staff proceed with immediate removal of the lower and middle Chase River dams and take the necessary steps to rebuild replacements for both dams and equip the lower dam to ensure it can be used for hydro generation. The motion carried, and that motion was presented by Councillor Brennan. So that was to replace. We have a report from Mr. Kenning, or authorized by Mr. Kenning, and it was quite a very good report. And I won't go through all these pages, but at the very end of the report, there's the indication about replacing. I will go to the June 10th from Mr. Bill Sims in regarding his report to council, and in his report, I won't read it, but it says here, while the removal project proceeds and design and approvals can be proceed on the dam, replacement structures with construction targeted for 2014. So we're going to replace. Then we have a report to council in July from Mr. Hickey to council. I won't go through it. But we get down to the last paragraph. It says, the city is just beginning the process of studying design and community engagement for rebuilding the dams, including an analysis of impacts on potential benefits on the Seamill Treaty protected fisheries. The city needs to work with SFN and engage them through the process. We're rebuilding these dams all the way through every discussion that the city has had in all this language. I'll go back because I've read a lot of stuff. There's this, boy, I was paid by the paper for these things. News release, update progress on culinary dam 30-day consultation. The province dam safety section in conversation with the city and the Seminole First Nation has acknowledged they are open to discussing a mitigation strategy that would allow both dams to remain in place over the winter months while discussions surrounding the future of the dams include whether or not to remove, rebuild, or remediate both structures continues. So the word is in there about replace. And then we have the information that's been ongoing on the city's website. And I won't read all this, but I'll go over to a point where it says here again, targeted park closure aims at making it safe, but it also states in a paragraph here about replacing the dams. So when I come down to the tendered contract that's before you, and I understand drawings, I've been doing this for 40 years, and I look at the drawings for what's going to be built up at the dam. There is no dam. There never will be a dam built ever again. I would challenge anyone to say that it would be rebuilt. I think it will cost a lot of money to take everything that you're going to do and then come back and rebuild it into a dam. Because what you're going to do is basically take the dams, restructure them into a 12-meter cut, and make a creek through the bottom, follow the profile, go down the slope, come around to the bottom of the chase, and we will have a creek through the park. Nowhere in the tender documents does it say about replacing the dams. It says dam removal. It doesn't say dam replacement. I can understand if there was a process on the drawings that said, you know, future or proposed applications on the drawing to say this is where the dam will be built at a later date, but there's nothing that shows that whatsoever. And the last thing I'm concerned with is in the notes, because I've been doing this a long time, these drawings are not for construction. I don't know whether there's drawings yet that have come up for construction, but these drawings are not for construction. And I believe right up to tendering time, nothing's changed. So that means the contractors that bid on this project could be given new drawings the day after they were awarded the contract. So I guess my question would be, is there any changes to these drawings that would be new drawings before council makes any kind of, takes any kind of direction on whether they would award or not award this tender, that all of a sudden $3,050,000 goes to $5 or $6 million because the drawings changed and some of the language has changed and it's not what the person has bid? So that's one of my concerns, because when I see notes like this, there's a lot of things that the engineer can discretionalize out in the field as they go along, and that's where costs can go up. And the last thing is, I wasn't going to point this out, but I'm going to point it out because this is what I do for a living. There's a river crossing sitting there that the city has installed. I've been doing this a long time. It is not seismic. I understand, and I've asked the question, I don't know if that line is active. I've been told it's active, but if that line is active, it's carrying chlorinated water, and it's hanging across the ravine between First and Second Lake, which if there was anything that happened, that line failed and ruptured and took all the water, which is chlorinated, and dumped it into the between the First and Second, it would now go into that and act as a contaminant for all the fish habitat that's existing in the First and Second. So I don't know if that line's active or not. Someone said it is, someone said it isn't. That's just my concern, because we're talking about seismic, we're talking about concerns, we're talking about earthquakes. I think, sir, we need to look at that.
That's anyway. 5.5 minutes. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank
Good
you.
Points.
Your Worship. Your Worship. Your Worship. Yeah. I have a question for Mr. Cake.
Okay. Sorry, Mr. Cake. We've got a question for you. Mr. Kay, Councillor Kay.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation, Mr. Kay. Now, that line that goes across the river, I noticed that it's mounted on cement pylons. One thing that struck me, and I understand this is your business, one thing that struck me interesting about the installation is that it appears that one side appears to have rubber mountings and the other side doesn't. Do you have any comment on that?
Well, I'm not an engineer, but I can comment because I've been doing this a long time and have worked with engineers in the design. The concrete structure that I see there, to me, are not, there's no support into the bedrock whatsoever as rebar or anything that would support it. And it's a 30-inch casing pipe with a pipe inside of it. And there's only a 2-bolt clamp. And in all of the years I've been doing this, the minimum I would see on those clamps is 4 bolts holding either side. So I'm not criticizing it. I'm just saying that there's a possibility if that did rupture or did fail, you're putting chlorinated water right in between the First and Second Lakes, which, you know, the issue is we're talking about seismic. So yes, I don't see those structures that strong. The support, there's 40 feet of pipe in between one side to the other. There's no support. That's a lot of weight sitting there. I've checked, those are mild steel bolts. So the question I would say is, I think just in suggesting to the city, I would look at that.
Thank you.
Okay, sir, thank you. Next speaker is Mr. Larry Gambone. Mr. Gambone, if you're here.
Darcy.
It says Larry on my list. Okay, the next speaker is Ms. Gwen Martin. Mm-hmm. And we'll move down to...
Worship.
Yeah.
Your Worship, we did miss one. Darcy Hennigman, number 30. We seem to have.
Oh, yeah, sorry, I did
individual.
Skip one. Is Darcy Hickman here? Okay, so now we'll go down to Ms. June Ross.
Good evening, Mayor and Council, and thank you for allowing yet another time here. It's the first time I think I've been before you on the Colliery Dams, but I do thank you for time on the agenda. Before I start, I wanted to ask a question, and I guess it goes to some comments that were made at the last meeting. My understanding of delegation presentations is that when there is more than one speaker on the same topic, we are allowed 5 minutes to speak. Further to this, I understand that when a delegate is given the floor to speak, that is their opportunity to have their say and to be heard. Following the presentation, then, it's my understanding that that is when council members may ask their questions or make comments. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Am I missing your point?
Well, I guess because we got a fairly large lecture from Diane Brannan, Councillor Brannan, during that last meeting, and it raised concerns for me, because if I'm given 5 minutes to speak, I expect the 5 minutes, and then I'll stand here for an hour and answer your questions. So that's just by way of comment, and thank you for the clarification. Okay.
I'm not sure I recall that Ms. Brennan denied, Councillor Brennan denied somebody the opportunity to speak for 5 minutes. Is that what happened? I'm not sure of the incident.
No,
I can't recall the incident.
It's when we're presenting, mm-hmm. and you did it to one of the delegates already here, when we're presenting, it's my opinion, parliamentary procedure says, you shouldn't interrupt.
Okay.
You shouldn't debate.
Okay.
Okay.
I understand your point.
Okay.
In my case, I'm not going to sit here and have staff trashed or belittled publicly. If there's statements that are made that are contrary to that, I think as the chair, it's out of order, that's all. And I've taken that liberty to make that point. And I think invariably, you know, we have a lot of similar speakers come before us on numerous occasions, usually every 2 weeks or so. And there's a lot of very respectful people that make a very nice case and make some excellent points, which we listen to. But once they start raising their voice and becoming argumentative and combative, then we have to draw the line, or else it gets out of hand very quickly.
And that's okay, and I guess, again, from my perspective, maybe the challenge to the speaker when they're speaking is what creates the combativeness. Anyway, it's just something for you to think about.
No, I appreciate that. I appreciate it.
So I guess I'm hopeful that this is going to be a momentous occasion. I hope that the vote goes the way we're all hoping. The special moments for me, and I have to say this because I'm not from the South End, the north, south, and east and west of Nanaimo have now finally been united, and I think that's totally astounding. The citizenry of Nanaimo is awakening from their sleep and realizing that politics are important as they touch every facet of our lives. So I'm hopeful that come election time, we're going to have a good turnout. We finally made friends with our First Nations peoples of Nanaimo. Everyone now realizes the importance of the vote at election time. Many new friends have been made by each of us with residents of the Harewood area, which is truly wonderful and amazing. Our love of our park that we have been fighting to save for 10 long months is even stronger, and we are all even more determined that it remain as it is. There are some downsides, and I guess the downsides from my perspective can also be upsides. It's taught our citizens that we have to watch what our politicians do, say, and do behind closed doors, and I hope a lesson's been learned there. I guess I want to just close off by thanking the four councillors who absolutely stood beside us and behind us and had a lot of belief in what the citizens were saying. Jeff Solomon and his Dam Preservation Society, I hope that as council that you see the huge amount of potential that the citizenry has with their knowledge base. There are engineers, there are biologists, there are geologists that are all doing the fight with us, and they have provided you with a lot of information that you haven't listened to until now, and I thank you for finally listening. And finally, I have to say a big thank you to Doug White, even though he has said things that we had been saying for months and months before, especially Jeff's group. He's at least made you listen. So please do the right thing and vote the way you know you must.
Okay, thank you. Now, the next speaker is Mr. Wesley Muris, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Are you coming down, sir, or are you leaving town here? Okay, come on down. And usually what happens, and I call for the next speaker, and somebody gets up, and I don't know if they're coming to the microphone or leaving. So, welcome, sir. You have 5 minutes.
Yeah, thank you. I'm Wesley Maroos from 758 Hunter Street. And I was here to thank council for the recommendation to postpone the destruction of the dams and wait for the winter. That's really positive, and I'm glad to hear that. And thank you for considering that the dams are a solid structure, that you actually kind of thought about it and said, hey, wait, maybe we can do something with these, because they are built on solid rock. They're natural basins that were just extended and made bigger for coal mining purposes. They were built, like, considering that they were built by professionals who did many more dams other than just the ones they did here. They did it right, and usually back then, and you saw in the diagrams with the rebar and that, they did it overkill, right? Stuff was cheap, concrete was cheap, metal was cheap, and they did it right. So thank you for considering that and having another look. The dams did also survive many earthquakes unscathed, undamaged. For example, the one earthquake in 1946, the Cowal Dam survived a 7.3 earthquake. Was at Forbidden Plateau. And from my accounts, from the report that I'm reading here, is the largest earthquake to ever occur on land in Canada. There was reports by eyewitnesses in that. This one article that I'm reading here says Old Man Dixon from Dixon's Pond, which is on 7th Street, just up from Park Avenue School. And he remembers that, or the, what he says here, the ground rolled like sea waves, and telephones were shaking and all that. And it was a pretty major occurrence. I remember my grandma telling me about that earthquake and how chimneys and everything crumbled all around. She told me many stories about that earthquake, but the dams were unscathed. They didn't crack, nothing happened to them, right? I know that was then, but they were built right. Right? They're strong, strong things. I'm here today. I wasn't gonna be a delegate, but then I thought I should, just because I am third generation from Nanaimo, more specifically Harewood area. I wish my dad was here. He passed away about 9 years ago, Don Maroos, and he really loved the dams. My family loved the dams. They have a big part tied to those dams. When I was like 1 week old, that's where my first place I went swimming. My family took me there and we went swimming. It was nice and close, and it was pretty much a family thing. I remember back when I was a kid that waiting for my dad to come home from work, because after he finished up in the Nanaimo Lakes working there, he came home, and then we'd go up the dam swimming pretty much almost every day. And that was like kind of a memorable time for me. They're really important bodies of water and places, right? I remember as a child, like 8, 9, every weekend my buddies would kind of get together on bikes and we'd go up there and fish and pretty much build memories that I have till this day. We're all still tight. I don't know if it was because of like really close together because of those or other things we've done, but they're big parts of me and who I am. My grandmother, Mary Maroos, she told me many stories, because she used to live on Pine Street, right on Old Victoria Road. And that's back in the days when Old Victoria Road ended at like Needham. Dinkle past James Grocer. And she told me stories of them walking down through the cow field, which is now Barsby, and up the other side and swimming and hanging out there. And that was kind of their recreational thing, because, well, it was back in the, I think, 30s, 40s, somewhere around there. And there wasn't much to do other than go there. It's kind of like today. There's video games or go up to the dam. So I choose the dam. It's a big historical part of Harewood too. And we need to keep it, definitely need to keep it, because you can see a lot of like destruction of certain historical sites, like Harewood School's really run down and sad. I spent a lot of time there too. And then other spots that were already mentioned previous. Mine is like Harewood Mall, how the name had changed. And kind of, to me, it kind of sells out, because now it's University Village And I don't know, that doesn't say Harrah to me. That says the university, so. I have a question that just comes to my head, is how we got here today. Like, why are we, like, how this process got to where we are today. Now, I'm happy that it's going in the direction it's going, but in retrospect, shouldn't this have happened in October? Like, what we're doing now and the direction we're going.
5 minutes is up now.
Okay, well, I'm almost done.
Sure.
And I just don't know how it came to this, and I'm hopefully that the community plan, communication plan, will help, like, for this not to happen again, and this backwardsness is that this whole process is going for, or now we're starting to write and go in the right direction with all the groups, like First Nations and Departments of Fisheries and community, everybody getting together and going in one direction.
Okay,
and,
sir.
Yeah, and thank you. I just had two more things.
Okay, really quickly, because
yeah,
we're up
quick.
To 6 minutes now.
What I got out of this is a sense of community, and not just for Harrah, but just for all the Nanaimo, and that's really positive. I'm really happy about that. And one thing I've kind of, well, not one thing, but major thing I've learned is who I'm not voting for. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now, the next speaker is Mr. Dale Schultz, is it? Welcome, sir.
Hi, folks. Hi. Dale Schultz, 776 Park Avenue. I had signed on as a delegation to speak about the awarding of the tender to remove the dams, and I had questions about it, but I'm just going to kind of go over just 2 points from that. I guess it's the whole idea of disposing of the dams rather than repairing them and maintaining them. It seems like everything, our first intention is to just throw everything away rather than looking for a way to fix it. And I thought that the awarding, if it had been voted on, it was a little rushed. You know, I put a new roof on my house last year and it took 3 weeks to decide which roofer to choose, and it wasn't anywhere near as big a job. It seemed like the historical value of the dams was downplayed a little bit, and I've heard it from people in Europe and people further away who say, well, those dams are only 100 years old, that's hardly history at all. But without recent history, you don't have the vaunted history. History is history, whether it's a year old or 100 years old. So I think it's important to try to keep as much of those dams as we can for that reason. And then I just wanted to thank everybody who's worked so hard to try to come to a solution. I know that there's a lot of people on council, the First Nations, a heck of a lot of people from Harewood. Everybody's been sort of coming together and trying to fix this. And I think that with a little more time and a good strategy for when the high water comes, I think we can find a way to do this without destroying the dams, without closing off the park. And so I just want to urge the council to vote in favor of canceling this tender, and urge council and everybody else to really spend the winter really talking about trying to come up with a way to mitigate any danger and to look at other ways. I get the feeling that because I walk in that park three times a week, and I have for 10 years, and there are days when I'm up there and I'm the only person at that park. And I always think, well, it's a real big area to police, to maintain, and to keep track of. It must be real expensive. And there should be a way we can get more tourists in there. Try to find ways to make money. Even a concession stand up there, if it's expensive to fix these dams, then let's look at some ways to make some money off of it, you know. I think some heritage tours, some collie watching tours, just try to get more people up there and find a way to make some money off of it, because it's acres and acres of land that really it's just money going out to take care of it all the time. So if we can find a way to maybe boost tourism and include that in the discussions, I think we'd be better off.
Okay.
But I want to thank you all for allowing me to speak and listening to everybody's research. So
thank you.
Thank you.
Now the next speaker is Ms. Shirley Press. Ms. Press. She's gone. Okay. And Ms. M.P. Montague is not here. And Mr. Fred Taylor.
Mayor Rattan and council members, one step at a time. We raise council pay. We create communications. On scene, a new enclosed chlorinated water storage tank, which includes overflow, outflow, whatever you may call it. Then demand for removal of the Collery Dams. They're in the way of dangerous chlorinated water. Only time will tell. Anyone consider the old number one reservoir to enhance Collery Dam's enjoyment? You missed the boat on that one. A resolution agreeable to all to save the Collery Dams to maintain a historic recreational environment is what we need. We elected you to represent us, no one else. Part of the job is to listen and provide direction for no less for higher pay. No one should be allowed to create studies against us, but to enhance our direction. Remember, we provided the report to the Dam Safety Branch, I suspect to support the direction of someone. Now, I have two questions to ask, please, in closing. The first one is, if in this case or any other case, a draft report is created firstly, does it come to council in camera or does council see the end product?
In what was the application in the draft proposal on a particular item, you mean, or just in general?
Well, any item. I'm not aware of a draft or how many drafts in this case, but other cases I am. And I'm asking if those drafts become before council firstly or the finished product.
I don't know if staff wants to make a comment. Generally, by the time it comes to council, it's more or less a finished letter or recommendation as opposed to a series of drafts on it. But council then takes it and debates it at length and decides whether or
not to proceed. Thank you. So draft reports that are within the records of the city, means they're not in camera, are available to the public, not to be refused, because they're not in camera, right?
You know, if draft copies are kept, I don't know.
We can make requests for draft reports now, once we got that clear.
Well, maybe.
Well, we're going to change now?
No. You asked a question. Can we not get an answer for you, sir?
Yes, you did. You gave me the answer.
But I don't know if the drafts are kept. You know, no two subjects are the same. Anyway, Mr. Swaby, please.
Worship, I can
be good if our CAO is here.
To make a request for draft reports, that's within his purview, and then we can deal with the request that he makes.
Okay.
Thank you. They've been refused in the past. Thank you, sir. And the last question I have to raise is, we have a records retention bylaw, and there's certain things that are kept for 1 year. And I believe delegations, speeches, etc., maybe one, that are destroyed after 1 year. Because this is going on, in my opinion, over a year. Could we have an amendment to that retentions bylaw now by a council member that all records for the Colliery Dam, for whoever you appoint to review this and everything, are maintained or kept until the issue is dealt with? In other words, we don't want to see anything that's a year old all of a sudden disappearing out of the city records. And that's a retention, records retention bylaw.
Okay, I think so, Councillor Bessie, do you have a question?
I think in fairness, all records for this issue has to be maintained.
Councillor Bessie, did you have a question?
I was just wishing to make a comment on the first question that Mr. Taylor asked, and I'm not certain that I have the answer, but oftentimes we receive reports for information only, and inside those reports is information, and not uncommon for that information to be provided to us many, many months in advance of when we really get to the meat of it or drill down to any decisions. So when we, and not just on this particular topic, but we'll have many reports that come to us for information only, and we really don't do anything other than accept it, pass it as for information only. We have all, I think, from time to time thought that that triggers, or at least I think we've thought that that triggers a direction, however. And then those reports, it's not uncommon for them to maybe change with time, change with information, change with circumstances that have made them, you know, larger, bigger, whatever, smaller, more condensed, or getting closer to an end result. But so as far as drafts are concerned, I don't recall receiving too many drafts, but for information only. And then just as, so I'm not sure if I helped you with that. And then the bylaw retention for information, it would seem to me that it would make practical sense now with the capacity, the capabilities that we have to load things on USBs and sticks and whatever else. It's not as though that we have rooms and rooms and rooms full of paperwork anymore and reams of paper. So it would seem appropriate. It wouldn't seem inappropriate from my perspective to retain information when we're dealing with matters that take many, many, many months to come to a finality. So it, yeah, absolutely would make sense, in my opinion.
Councillor Bestwick, I would like to agree with you that in years gone by, say 100 years, you could go to the city vault and see handwritten letters from residents about a problem, etc. And all of a sudden, we've taken steps to eliminate that sort of stuff. And I think as technology improves all the time, and you can scan something in, it's a benefit for historic research, everything, to maintain as much as we got or can get. And I think it's time that retentions bylaw came back to you people for review.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, the next delegation is Bruni Bruni.
Hi, Bruni Bruni, 1300 Stewart Avenue. My dear Mayor Rattan and honorable councillors, you have had an opportunity to flex the powers given to you by the people of Nanaimo, the people who trust you to do the right thing. Although it is the city manager, Al Kenning, who cut the dam deal, promising millions to waiting contractors.
No, that's not true.
The Collier Dams are the heritage of Nanaimo, the birthplace of my great-grandmother and my place now forever. It is believed that the dams were constructed by Newcastle Island sandstone, which has been tested 5 times to be the purest and the strongest in the whole world. This is in history, it's a fact. They built other dams, tunnels, bridges,
and buildings that have gone through earthquakes that are still standing today. The Collier Dams are a place of healing, a place for lovers. And there's no one that can't go there that will feel the tranquil power of peace and harmony. It is, in fact, a magical place. And I thank you all for your change in attitude. And I thank Chief Doug Waite for the standoff that he did. And I thank especially Councillor McKay for getting things moving. And I hope that the community of Nanaimo will have an opportunity to weigh in on what is going to happen and present options, like, for instance, a self-sufficient power project that could be there in times of emergency, or bus tours for seniors so they could get a glimpse of Collie Dammy. And Collie Dammy smiles and says, just keep those damn fish coming.
Thank you. Okay, next delegation is Mr. Jeff Solomon.
I don't think it's fair that I go after Bruni Bruni. I'd never measure up to that. So. But I'm going to try, okay? So I think it is, it's reasonable to question things. I really do appreciate the fact that you're having a relook at this situation. I know it's been a tough one for you, and thank you very much for that. I really do. Questioning things in many ways, including engineering studies that we just simply don't take for granted. You got some emails today, I think, and from a lady, Gail Radford Ross. She's a very good researcher, and she gets her information correct. She's pointed out that only 8 lives have been lost worldwide from a failed dam due to an earthquake since record-keeping started in 1900. Now, you have to realize that the classification of the dams are related to the number of potential casualties. So we are talking that every dam in the entire world would fall under the category of classification of the 1 in 3,000, or built to a 1 in 3,000 year event, not this 1 in 10,000 year event. I'll read this right from her letter. Dam failures do happen. Only 8 lives have been lost due to a dam failure caused by an earthquake. This was at Fuji Jujunama Dam in 2011 earthquake off the Pacific coast of Tohoku. A 9 magnitude earthquake, the 4th most powerful earthquake in the world since record keeping began in 1900. The earthquake moved Honshu, the main island of Japan, 8 feet east and shifted the earth on its axis by estimates of between 4 and 10 inches. Despite the severity of this earthquake, reportedly of the 252 dams that were inspected, only 7 were found to be damaged. If an earthquake of that magnitude hits Nanaimo, the dams will be least of our worries. This has been said many, many times, and that is the truth. Okay. So the dams, there was a concern about the dam, the same issue, the middle dam toppling and the water spilling into the lower dam. That issue was brought up in the 70s when the city assumed control of the dams, and they were fixed in 1980. And that was specifically the issue that they dealt with. I'm going to pass these 2 pieces of metal around. And if we can just, and I don't know how much you're going to see here, but in some of the reports, and I went through them, of course, remember, these are said to be the worst, the most dangerous dams in the province, basically, at this stage of the game, okay? So, but, you know, they passed every inspection, including 2012 inspection, when they were said to be, that they were going to be gone. So we go back to 2003, we just talk about the rebar. It said no evidence of the reinforcement, although it would be likely, and the middle dam, rebar in the spillway suggests for reinforcement and suggests testing for rebar in the middle. So there's a few slides I have. I don't have, it's just giving you a sense of what's out there. You know, this one here is under the bridge. Now, the bridge is not the original structure, and what you see here is this is newer construction. What we want is we want the best stuff, and that was way back then. We don't want the newer stuff, because this is what you get. You get rusting. This was probably built in the 70s. This is the little bridge at the middle dam, and the rebar is starting to rust. You can see that piece of rebar that you have, the original rebar, is about 5 times the density of what you get now. Okay, so we're talking. This is when they said, and Wesley said, overbuilt. This is what they did. They built it strong, and they built it to last. They built it for indefinite purpose. That's a little bit of a closer picture of it. There's all sorts of metal in there that gives it a tremendous amount of strength. Remember, the whole idea of this, and it was said, it wouldn't fail if it was reinforced. Well, there was an assumption, and I'm not sure why, there was an assumption that wasn't reinforced, and there was no testing. I actually asked for that, why it wasn't looked at being reinforced. But it was reinforced, and there's some significant amount of reinforcement as well as a lot of strength. These are big, big chunks of iron that go through the dam. I don't know how well you see, but it's not like they're just little piddly things. It gives you a sense of what's in there. And so this thing ain't just, that's Sean. He's a very good guy. And you see it's pitted on the front there, underneath the water. It's not. It's all pretty smooth. This is some of Sean's photos. So a diver can actually see some of this, and you can do testing. It's very possible. It's all dead. There's some kids and some dogs. And that's what the dam is used for on a regular basis, and that's what we'd lose if we lost this precious resource. When we talk about the entire ecosystem, I mean, the crayfish or whatever, there's fish, it's all part of the system. It feeds and feeds and feeds, and when you talk about those otters being up there, well, what are they chowing down on? They're chowing down on those crayfish because this is like their big delicacy. It's what they love. This is just some of the ecosystem. Anyway, there you go. So I just wanted to, the reviews are clear. You know, you go back to history. When we talk about 1946, it was a significant earthquake, and we didn't have the supports in those dams. And there was no cracking, and each of the reviews say, okay, I'll say exactly what it says in reviews. There's no actual deficiencies. There's no signs of deterioration of the concrete. No cracking, no settlement of the slope or instability. The structures and the spillways are in satisfactory condition.
We're over 6 minutes now, so if you
yes.
can wind
okay,
up,
and please. I just have two more things, and I'll be right with you. So this is what we have on record. Okay, these aren't dams to be condemned. They're actually dams that can be improved. The spillways can be improved. That's possible. I'm also going to mention one other thing. Dam safety branch. This has been an issue, okay? And I don't want to, they're a significant authority, but they have been erratic in their statements at best and inappropriate at worst. These letters that have arrived at inopportune times really lend doubt to the credibility of the entire program, and we weren't thrilled with that involvement. And I've put it on record, and I've sent it over here. There was a letter that I sent in terms of my concerns about that program. If you're dealing with them now, and you're dealing with the mitigation of the risk for the interim, please keep it in mind that we're all taxpayers here. We don't want untold dollars spent in inappropriately. If you have to deal with something, please do it with the least intrusive measures and the least cost. And that's what we want. And thank you very much again for re-looking at the situation. It's very, very much appreciated. But I need my medal back, okay?
And the next delegation is Miss Jennifer Harvey. Is Jennifer here? No? Yes? No? So the next speaker after that is Mr. Jim, I'm sorry, I'll have trouble with the air clipping. Sorry.
Hi, thank you again for reconsidering your plan. I hope through this whole process we've come to understand that we're dealing with a recovering ecosystem. This is this little park has been treated terribly over the centuries and over the years. First, a bunch of coal miners manipulated the valley, and then more lately, the city council has decided to put a pipeline through the middle of it. A few years ago, they built a road across it. They built roads around the side of it. And for some reason, you've decided to put a big tank in a chunk of it without even asking our permission about that. So this is a recovering ecosystem that's still not being treated very nicely, and that's my main concern here. We're concerned about public safety, of course, and one of the most dangerous things for the public is having the upper part of this valley controlled by a timber company. They've been clear-cutting it steadily. They clear-cut 1,000 hectares almost 10 years ago that put a big plume of dirt into the Jump Lake where we get our water from. If you climb up Westwood Ridge, you'll see a big clear-cut on both sides where they paid no attention to the Forest Practices Code, because the Forest Practices Code said you have to leave all the water courses with a 10-meter leaf strip on both sides, a riparian zone. They ignored that. You can see that anytime you want to walk up Westwood Ridge and head on south, you can see it on both sides of the ridge. And this is above our watershed. And of course, when you take the trees and the plants off, which they did, and bulldozed right down to the rock, the water goes in instead of staying on the leaves and being taken up by the trees. So all that water that would have been recycled into the atmosphere goes down into the water, brings all the arsenic and heavy metals into our water supply. And this is far more important to the safety of the citizens of Nanaimo than the possible failure of the dams, which may be the last gasp of the watershed. We're very unfortunate, Nanaimo, that we don't have to buy the land from Islands Timberland. We can expropriate it. We have that right under the our right as citizens, as elected citizens. You have that right. The land is not owned by Island Timberlands. When John A. MacDonald gave the timber rights and the mining rights to the Dunsmuirs, he could not give the land to them because the land is Nanaimo First Nations land. So we have the opportunity here to expropriate that land, the same thing that Vancouver and Victoria have already done. They've expropriated their watersheds where they get their drinking water, and return it to a pristine condition under the direction of our First Nations that own the land. All we have to do is recognize that ownership and then expropriate it under the direction of the First Nations. That's what I suggest we do. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, the next speaker is Mr. Dominic Jones. Not here. Then we go down to Mr. Adrian Parker. And then we're going down to Mr. Frederick Collin. Mr. Collin. Then we're down to Ms. Stacy Nielsen. Ms. Stacy here. And now we're going down to our last speaker, Mr. Robert Fuller. Oh yeah, he is here.
Robert Fuller, 3350 Hammond Bay Road. I'm going to start my presentation off with two excerpts from two fairly substantial documents that the city, staff, and the citizens produced. The first one is, we intend to be known and earn respect for positive relationships, community engagement, and participatory democracy based on effective consultation and open communications. This is on page 5 of the 2012-2015 Corporate Strategic Plan. The second excerpt is, building trust is a crucial element in creating the connections that lead to successful two-way communication. Thus, attention to how council, staff, and citizens relate to each other and understand one another's messages must thoroughly be considered. This is from page 4 of the Nanaimo Communication Plan. I've come to council today to speak as a citizen, taxpayer, and stakeholder in the city of Nanaimo. During the 9-month deliberation on the Colliery Dams issue, I've tried to remain as impartial as one could on a subject that is important to all of us. What began with one of the all but regular in-camera meetings council holds has extended for many months with little in the way of conclusions or finality. I've watched as city staff and some on council seem to have made a decision from the start and gone into this process with blinders on, not willing to listen to alternative views. I've heard dollar figures bandied around that are so far apart and guesses at best that it seems incomprehensible to even myself. I've been told that the dams are in deplorable shape and must come down to save life, limb, and property, only to find out that they seem to be in pretty good shape and have reinforcement that seems adequate. I've seen a process unfold which confounds my common sense, bleeds taxpayer dollars on studies that seem flawed, and more importantly, on the time involved to get to where we are today. I've watched citizens step forward with impassioned pleas to save these structures and their park, only to be met by some with blank stares of disinterest. And where are we at now? Right back at square one, starting on a process of consultation and collaboration, which in my mind, in my opinion, should have begun many months ago. In the end, what I am left with is, personally, you have lost my trust. And from conversing with others, I'm not alone. That speaks volumes about people elected, whom are supposed to have the best interest of the citizens of Nanaimo at heart. I don't trust staff who seem to have gone into such an important decision with minds made up, and sometimes devil be damned anyone else's opinions or cares. Councillor Patchy said it best at the council meeting on June the 10th. The first order of business for me as an individual is to try and regain some of that trust, if not all of it. We need to do that before anything else, because whatever we do is doomed to failure if we do not get that trust back. In the end, I'm left with two questions. How are you going to gain the public's trust back? And my second question is, when will the minutes of the in-camera meeting, including the vote on this issue, be released? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, that concludes the speakers. And we'll move now into staff recommendations and the motion. One, sorry, Councillor Kipp, go ahead.
Oh, I'll make the motion. Staff recommendation one, I'd like to do them, I guess, seriatim, just for people to
okay.
see. But
seriatim,
I'll make the motion that we cancel tender 1445, removal of middle and lower Chase River Dam.
Second. Okay, moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. You did have it unanimous too, is the question? Yeah, I had that, and I just want to make sure that I was correct on that. Do you want to do two?
Sure. Director, okay. Staff to transfer the $2.5 million proposed to be used from the 2012 surplus to a special reserve to be used in the future for work associated with the risk mitigation of Colliery Dams.
Second. Moved and seconded again. Any further discussion?
Yep.
Okay, Councillor Kipp.
Yeah, I just wonder, a question to staff, how does this fit into our asset management plan that they're currently working on? It seems like now this is a big bump in an asset management because we've been putting the 1% aside we're looking at over the next years. So how does this affect that? And is this just not ongoing or more mitigation work that's kind of sped up?
Is this ready?
Yes, Your Worship. Certainly part of the $2.5 million that's requested to be transferred included some of the current asset management money, and we would be looking next year, depending on what the cost of any solution that's brought forward, to look for more of that money potentially to be allocated to the dams, depending on how we want to proceed.
With a follow-up on that too, If we found that, that this was there, it could be moved to something else after two, couldn't it?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Bessig.
Thank you, Worship. A question to staff. Is it reasonable for me to assume that these monies will accrue an interest? It says into a special reserve fund. Is it reasonable to assume that these monies will be placed into a special fund that accrues an interest, or does it just is it just set aside without the ability to earn additional revenues? Because it is a significant number.
Your Worship, that's a good question. If it accrues interest, it's minimal, but I can report back to Council on that, on where we place the money.
Your Worship, I would suggest that any interest that we could accrue on $2.5 million is important. So my, regardless of whether it's a minimal amount or a more significant amount, whatever that means relatively speaking, then I would like to ensure that this money's is in a special account that has the ability to generate an interest and not just sit dormant in some special reserve that doesn't have that ability, regardless of the amount. 1%, 25 grand, I like it.
Absolutely, Your Worship. We will be accessing this account, I expect, fairly shortly as we move forward with any winter mitigation that Council wishes to engage in. So it's not as if we can put the money into some account, investment account. This, if we receive any, would just be the nominal amount of interest that you would gain through having it in a typical bank account. But this in this case in particular, we'll be utilizing the money ongoing as we move forward.
Thank you, Your Worship. I understand that in point four is when we're going to determine what our move forward position will be with considerable more consultation and more information forthcoming. And so in the meantime, prior to getting to the point where we'll be expending these dollars that we're allocating, I would just like to ensure that our finance department is looking after the best interests of those dollars for how ever long we have them in an account, and for how whatever percent that we can generate from it versus sitting in a drawer, so to speak.
That's, okay, and you're going to look into that and get back to the Council?
Your Worship, we're here to serve, and I will bring back a report on how we deal with the money.
Okay, thank you. Okay, it's been moved and seconded. I see no further questions. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. Three.
To bring back a short-term risk mitigation plan
at the first available opportunity.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion on that? Councillor McKay.
Thank you, Your Worship. This reads a little bit clunky in my mind. Staff recommendation that Council, if you read this one separately, that Council bring back a short-term risk mitigation plan at the first available opportunity. That Council. So I would expect there would be others involved in this plan, and I'm concerned about that, the short-term risk mitigation plan, because it goes on to say in 4 and 5 that we're going to involve others. What I was hoping we might be able to do is look at a friendly amendment to that that would read, prior to bring back, it would, in front of that, with the assistance of senior public staff, or public, with the assistance of senior public work staff, comma, Sonamo First Nations staff, comma, and some, a group that I believe we should consider as a full stakeholder, and the Collary Dam Preservation Society, comma.
I think that's appropriate. It, almost the and number three almost ties into four in that regard.
It's close.
And a good one.
And you support it too? Is the seconder?
Yeah. To the original motion, I'll support the amendment, the friendly amendment.
Okay. So, did we get it, Ms. King? Are you?
Your Worship, just well, Ms. Sure. King's particular Council is interested.
What's wrong with the microphones? We're having all kinds of feedback. Sorry. Well, I just show only two on now.
Your Worship, sorry to interrupt. If council is interested in naming stakeholders, which that's up to council, I would encourage you to consider the school board, as the school board is requesting to actually be part of any mitigation and discussions regarding the dam as well.
If we do that, I would... Are you going to... Well, if we do that, maybe you might want to excuse yourself.
Well, Your Worship, might I just ask the mover of the friendly amendment to be specific in his friendly amendment so that we know if, in fact, or whether or not we're dealing with the school board as a named member of the friendly amendment before we ask people to start leaving or surmising what the friendly amendment is yet. So if I could ask the mover of the friendly amendment specific in the friendly amendment so that we can deal with it.
Thank you, Your Worship. It was never my intent to have the school board as a participant in the conversation. That would be like us being invited to have a conversation about what they do with their facilities. Yes. So.
Okay.
So to clarify the amendment, it would basically say, under two, it would read the Colliery Dams, stop, and then three, with the assistance of Senior Public Works staff, Suname First Nation staff, and the CDPS, comma, and. Oh, pardon me. It would after CDP, it would bring back a short-term risk mitigation plan at the first available opportunity, and. So basically what I'm trying to do is put everything I've suggested at the front end of it.
I understand the motion.
Just a second. We've got, I want to first of all find out, Ms. King, are you?
Your Worship, my understanding is that the friendly amendment would be that with the assistance of Public Works, Senior Public Works staff, Suname First Nation staff, and Colliery Dam Preservation Society members, bring back a short-term risk mitigation plan at the first available opportunity. I believe yes. That's the motion.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's it, and the mover and seconder approve. Okay, I've got a couple of questions. Councillor Johnson first, and then Councillor Brennan.
Councillor Johnson first. I would like to declare a conflict and leave. I think that there is a specific omission, and that given that the omission is with regard to the school board, it was considered to be omitted. I think that on that ground, I should leave for this vote.
All right. Okay, well, the minutes can show that Councillor Brennan absented herself for perceived conflict of interest. And Councillor Johnstone.
Thank you, Your Worship. I would have absolutely no objection to having the school board as part of the people that are involved in the discussions. We've just been undergoing some very good school board to council discussions with regard to assets and land management and swapping of properties, Your Worship. And I think that they're very much involved and should be with the close proximity of the school, and they're very concerned, of course, about the risk to the safety of the school children in the floodplain. So I certainly would not have an opposition to having them involved.
Okay, let's just move. We've got several different speakers here. Councillor Patchy.
Thank you, Worship. I will not be voting for the amended one and the one previous because I believe that number three, written as it is short and sweet, and anything that we're going to add on to that is playing in my mind with the very short time frame that we have. And so I don't want to complicate it any further. As Councillor Kipp pointed out earlier, what follows in number four takes care of everything that I want to see taken care of. So I don't need to be that specific to make sure that Shinemo is involved, that the Collier Dam Preservation Society involved, and anybody else who should be. I don't have to be specific about it.
Okay, there's a couple other people, but I just want to say something myself, that I feel there's no reason we couldn't have incorporated number three and number four the same by simply having both the short-term and the long-term risk of mitigation involved in it, because I'm not sure why it's necessary to have a simple little sentence like that. I would like to see them incorporated, and I won't be able to support naming those specific ones myself for the very same reason. I agree with you that then when you start limiting certain people, you can create all kinds of problems. Councillor Kipp, did you have something to add?
Well, from my perspective, I agree that the original motion bringing back a short-term risk mitigation and the number four to continue and engage SFN, I believe we should be doing that. And I think what I think Councillor McKay, and he can change it if I'm wrong, but I think he's trying to clarify that we want those partners involved in the short term as well as the long term. And I think that's what. As for the portion on the school district, they really haven't been involved up to this point. They've had they made a statement on it. And my perspective, if they understand there's a risk at that school, they can do some issues to mitigate. It is their risk, the school children and that. So I wouldn't involve them. It's kind of late for them to enter in.
Okay, Councillor Beswick.
Thank you, Worship. My understanding of the amendment would deal with short and long-term mitigation impacts, and not just the long-term and number four. So that's precisely why I'm comfortable to support it. So we're having the same people deal with short and long-term, and not that council return with the mitigation plan, that council direct staff and others named to work toward swiftly the short-term mitigation plan. Secondly, on the topic of the school district's engagement, I would have to ask staff, do we have an official position from the school board, from their chair? Do we have a specific position in writing on their position as it relates? Or are we simply thinking that they may have a vested interest in given the proximity?
You're on.
We specifically, I forwarded an email earlier today to council, albeit late in the day, where they feel they've been cut out of the process and wanted assurances that they would be involved in any further discussions, which we would normally do. I was just worried that if council makes a specific motion that excludes people, we wouldn't be doing it, and I would be informing them of such. So that's really sort of the dynamic that's playing out, is that they have specifically wondered why we haven't been engaging them and want it to be engaged, which I thought was appropriate given that they're in the inundation study area.
And that was today?
That's correct.
Well, I don't find that it's excluding anybody. I think that if anybody, if we choose to ask anybody to come as a guest and be an observer or a bystander or otherwise at any of the meetings that we have, that all we're simply doing is saying these are the people that we don't want to exclude, per se, that it's going to be inclusive of these groups. And if you would like to come and sit on the back wall and listen to what it is that we're doing, and if you have any input, great. But to this point, as late as today, that we didn't receive anything, it makes it even more difficult for it to be palatable for me.
Okay, Councillor McKay.
Thank you, Your Worship. My reason for the friendly amendment is to recognize that we're not doing item number three, the short-term mitigation plan, in isolation. That's my big concern. With respect to the school board, Chief White and two of his staff members are here tonight. I don't recall at any of the council meetings, any of the meetings at John Bardsby, any of the events at the dams, that I've ever once seen a representative of the school board. So coming at this late hour, I just don't think it's on.
Okay.
But again, it's my intent to on the resolution, and I intend to also include reference to the CDPS in the following two portions of the motion as well. Recommendations.
Okay, Councillor Greaves.
Thank you, Your Worship. Now I'm getting confused by the number of resolutions you've putting forward here, and I'm not comfortable with all these changes. I think number three handles it appropriately. I think if we're going to have a short-term risk mitigation plan, staff will include everybody that should be included. I shouldn't name this person, that organization. If staff's going to include the people that they think they should include, then I'm sure they'll include the appropriate people. And four is fine too, but we're on number three right now. So anyway, I'm not going to, I'm not in support of, of your resolution. I think I will vote against it. I would like to go back to number three as it is written. Thank you.
Okay. We've got Councillor McKay. Have you got a fairly brief one here? You're on again?
Certainly. I just wanted to say that that it's my intent by including these. So often we get back from our staff, rightfully so, that the reason we did this specifically was because of your instructions to us. So I was just hoping by adding those additional words that it clarifies our instruction to them so they know exactly what they're doing and what their tasks are. That's the reason for the amendment.
Okay, Councillor Kipp.
Well, I'm not certain now if that the motion or your amendments were friendly anymore. It is. I mean, it is a tough one because I understand all the points on bringing back the just the initial motion. I guess what my point on this is four and five to me are probably of a higher priority than two. Is right. Making sure we're communicating. I think that's where we failed before. So I think it. So do we need to defeat this motion now as it was friendly amended and then bring back the other motion?
Yes.
I think, or yeah. We vote on it. I guess we should call the question. Call the question on the friendly amendment.
Well, we'll get some clarification on it.
Yeah, I am too.
Your Worship, it would be appropriate to vote on the motion with the friendly amendment at this time.
Okay. So this motion, rather, the vote now will be on the one with the friendly amendments intact. So all those in favor. We have Councillor Kipp, Councillor Beswick, and Councillor McKay in favour. Opposed? We have the balance of council opposed. The motion is defeated. Okay. Would somebody like to bring?
I'll bring back three. Three. And you can bring back Councillor Brennan. I'll just bring back.
In one motion?
Bring back a short term risk mitigation.
Okay.
So just number three is written.
Okay. Motion on the floor is to bring.
Do you want to wait till time?
Yeah, the motion on the floor is to bring back short-term risk mitigation plan at the first available opportunity, and that's as set up on three. So we're now going to vote on three, Councillor Brennan, in the exact form that's there. Okay, and it's been moved and seconded. Sorry, Councillor Beswick. Okay.
When we say the first available opportunity, do we have a timeline or a window where we believe that we will be returning with the proposed short-term mitigation plan?
Your Worship, as we work through the mitigation over the winter with this Nanaimo, it's imperative that we find a way to get this in place before the rains occur, because primarily the issues that we're going to be dealing with are the flood issues, which is the lower dam issue. So we've already been, we already have it in play. We're going to need the Colliery Dam Society to help us with some of the ideas that we have there for notification downstream. We're going to review with the Nanaimo the issues that we're mutually both aware that we've been undertaking for this issue. And the first available opportunity in September is when I would like to get it back to Council in front of you, something that both the Nanaimo Colliery Dam Society, in consultation with all the public, if we can, including the school board, that's acceptable to council, because as a body you would have to approve it because there's going to be costs associated with it.
Okay, could we suggest 60 days, Mr. Swaby? Is that something that's realistic?
Yes.
Call the question, Your Worship.
Okay, Councillor Johnston.
Just a quick one, Your Worship. That short-term mitigation plan will have a full cost analysis. Included.
Yes,
thank you.
Okay, we're voting on three as it stands. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion Move forward. Oh, okay. So that now into number four, Councillor Kim.
Continue to engage in Sonoma First Nation and the public in return, I would say, and the Colliery Dam Preservation Society in return for the first opportunity to council to adopt a new strategy to deal with the long-term mitigation of risks associated with the dams. I've added in the Colliery Dam Preservation Society in this.
Okay.
As if I hope. As a,
okay. That's been, is there a seconder on that?
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Discussion on that, Councillor Brennan.
Can I ask so that I can determine whether I have a conflict? Is this a specific decision to exclude the school board? I mean, or not?
I just need to know that.
I believe the school board will be kept informed, as the email said. You might not have heard as you're out of the room, and yeah. I don't know if the mic's wrong, but the staff intends to keep them informed.
And just further, if I can, Councillor Gibb, it wasn't your intention to
eliminate them. No. I want someone included, that's all.
The word I'm seeing here is engage other parties, so I'm just wondering, is it to specifically not engage? Is it just to inform? Those would be the things that I would have to take into account to determine whether I'm in a conflict.
It says engage.
Okay.
Your Worship.
Go ahead. Yeah, you're on.
The Sonoma plays such an important role in how we move forward with anything in the Chase River. That's why it's worded the way it is. We'll certainly be engaging, seeking input, all sorts of words that would talk about how the community is engaged, but these are important words because the Sonoma and the city are partners in how we're moving forward with this proposal.
Okay. I don't know why we keep getting such feedback here. So we have Councillor Brennan, you're okay with that then? So we're going to, and you have the phrasing, Ms. King, we're just going to have the one addition to the motion?
That's my understanding of the motion, okay. Your Worship.
Are we all okay? So we're on four. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. Now, do you want to do five?
Number five, direct staff to provide a recommended process that outlines the key steps and estimated completion date of each step that will focus the organization on diligently addressing the life safety and property concerns that have been made known to the city and the Sonoma Council and the community. This recommendation take into consideration the commitments of City Council to thoroughly engage the Sonoma First Nation and the community at large as identified in the 30-day process that has recently been completed.
Moved and seconded. Discussion, Councillor Beswick.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just as we're preparing to vote on this, I would just wish to take this opportunity to compliment everybody for their perseverance and their tenacity and their passion and their love for those things that are important to them. I think through adversity, good things happen, good things occur. And if you don't persevere and if you lay down, then typically you get what you deserve. So I just want to give a huge congratulations to those people from Harewood and beyond, those people that are in the audience now, for continuing their spirit to not give up. And it makes me very proud to be from Nanaimo, to know that we still have that in us and to be a Harewood boy. And I would really like to compliment Sonoma First Nations for their engagement and involvement and continuing to do so. And all of those hardworking members of our community who have done all of this work pro bono on their time to bring this information to us to make this take place tonight. This is a very important day today. Thank you very much.
Councillor Patchy.
Thank you. Before voting on this last item, Your Worship, I also want to say a few words of thanks, in particular to Catherine Gordon and her assistant, John McCormick, for their work in the 30-day facilitation process, without which I don't think we would be here. And I want to thank the chief for his initiative in the 30-day process. Without that, we also would not be here. So thank you very much for that. But, Your Worship, I also want to say something about our own staff. And I'm going to single out Tom Hickey, Susan Clift, and Bill Sims, who, in my opinion, have performed their professional duties with the required diligence, often under very difficult and stressful situations and circumstances, but always, always in accordance with the direction that this council gave them. And I think it's of extreme importance that all of us acknowledge that. The buck stops with us, not with them. Thank you, Your Worship.
Well, thanks, Councillor Patchy. And I just wanted to say, oh, Councillor Johnson, did you have something too?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I would like to echo Councillor Patchy's remarks. I was going to speak to that as well, and to thank particularly our staff in the past 30 days during that time we were taking a step back and addressing the fisheries issues and all the rest of it. And to thank publicly Chief Doug White's staff as well. They've put in countless hours to get us to this point. And I'd like to say to the gallery, the people out there in the gallery, we've been accused of making our mind up in the beginnings. We've come full circle on this. There were no minds made up. No minds. We've listened to our citizens. It's taken some time, but from October the 12th to remove and renaturalize, to May the 13th to remove and replace, to July the 8th to take the 30 days to listen to the First Nations and the rest of our citizens, I believe we've listened, and all of us, everyone in this room and every member, all my colleagues, there's only ever been one thing at the top of all of our minds, and that is public safety. And I have every confidence that with the ability of our staff and the input we're going to get from the community, that issue will be addressed. And I guess I just have to say, I pray that we have a mild winter, Your Worship, that we get all of the studies in place. No, serious, I want to ensure, I pray that we have a good winter and no flooding issues, and that we can get the mitigation in place that none of our citizens are going to be harmed.
No, I agree with all that. You know, I've got Councillor. I just was going to say, and then I'll come back to Councillor McKay, that I too want to thank Chief White and High School. We've worked very closely together for the last few months on a number of projects, and I think Catherine Gordon was very, very helpful in getting a direction established. And to your staff, Chief, they were always available, always prepared to engage, and always had a very good suggestion and recommendations to make. And I certainly appreciated that very much. And, you know, I think we're going to be able to, I think Catherine Gordon's away on holidays right now, but I think there's a lot of challenges that are going to come forward. But I just wanted to say how much I've enjoyed your trust and friendship, looking forward to things, Chief. I think we've lots more issues we're going to deal with, and I thank you for that very much. To John McCormick and also Catherine Gordon, a big thank you, although neither one of them I don't think are here tonight. Councillor McKay.
Thank you, Your Worship. I just wanted to just briefly touch on leadership. And through this whole process, there have been a number of leaders that have emerged. I really want to acknowledge, I very much wanted to acknowledge Mr. Jeffrey Solomon. It's been a pleasure to meet all of you. I want to acknowledge Chief Doug White. I want to acknowledge Mr. Hickey and his staff, and I want to acknowledge the mayor for leading us through this really difficult time. But we have a lot of leaders in this community. Thank you.
Sorry?
Question.
Yes. Yeah. It was on number five, was it? That. What have we got left? Just the fifth?
Your Worship.
Was there a change?
Recommendation number five is the motion on the floor.
Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. And we're moving into notice of motion. I don't think there are any other business. And then we move into seventh question period.
Motion adjourned.
Okay. There's a second. Okay. We stand adjourned. Thank you very much.